Thank you very much, Susannah, and thank you for the invitation, Lyndsay, very much. Could we put the first slide on, please? So I'm an artist working with installation, film, video, and often incorporating objects and built structures into my work. And for many years I've been working with a voice as a central material. It started most concretely when I left England to go and study in Holland, and found myself working and living it with English as a second language and constantly encountering familiar words being spoken in ways that gave them new meanings or gave them surprising meanings. And this began a process which had started before I left already, of questioning my own language. I'd come actually to film and video and to my current practice through sculpture and a very material spatial practice, and had started to question the way that I narrated that question to myself, how I described my work to myself, and how helpful or how efficient the language I was using was being. And I was referring very much to architectural discourse, architectural theory. When I went to Holland and started this process of questioning how I was speaking, the kinds of vocabulary I was using, questioning the terms, the kinds of values that might be attached to the words I was using, this started to a process of tackling a question which continues really until now, which is the basic question of whether I or you have a voice, and if we do have a voice, whose voice is it? The use of space, physical space, in sculptural installations has always kind of come through in single screen works, as you saw today in Barabak Starabang, also in the physical space of video installations, in ways in which real physical space takes on metaphorical values or resonances. So the space of the imaginary, the space of memory, the space of subjectivity are being addressed somehow or touched on or invoked through the physical space of a gallery, or the space between images and objects in a gallery, and of course the frame of the video or film image. And these spaces I see as, of course, always being somehow cut across by defining borders or thresholds. And the central threshold that I've been interested in my work is the idea of the threshold of language, or the border of language. What that means is addressed in different ways in each work that I make. But I would say broadly, the borders of language could be said to be where different forms of language meet, different terms of meaning, or where language is no longer working, where language has been lost for some reason, perhaps for a physiological or a neurological reason, or perhaps in the cases where an intense experience can no longer be circumscribed by language, a language is no longer effective in transmitting or communicating what you want to say. This image that you're looking here is some graffiti that I saw in Jerusalem in 2007 when I was working on an exhibition at the MUCA, the Museum of Contemporary Art in Antwerp, around the borders of language, taking a piece I'd made in 2007 for Documenta in Kassel and using that as a kind of curatorial map, out of which to draw several lines of inquiry through the works of many other artists. So it was a group exhibition, basically. Works which talked about or embodied different forms and terms of language, the space of architecture, the space of speech, body language, and so on. And walking through Jerusalem one day, I'd gone to do to show some work in an exhibition in Tel Aviv, preparing this exhibition, thinking about the whole thing, about the title and so on, I was explaining the basis of it to a friend and talking about the shibboleth, which is a term you're probably familiar with. For those who aren't, it's a biblical term from the Old Testament, and it refers to a battle between the Gileadites and the Ephraimites, who are two tribes who were visibly not different from each other, and they couldn't tell each other apart. And so in order to determine who was enemy, who was friend in the heat of the battle, they used language to distinguish between the two sides, and they used the word shibboleth, which is pronounced differently by each tribe. So one tribe pronounced it sibboleth, the other shibboleth. So this is a word which exposes the identity of the speaker. As I was explaining this to my friend Robin, she said, but there's a shibboleth over there. I said, what's that? Dalaki bush. No, it's not Dalaki bush. It's Dilaki bush, or something, which is Hebrew, a perfect, this becomes a perfect phonetic transcription of the Hebrew phrase, stop the occupation. So what I'd been looking at as some kind of bit of nonsense, or perhaps referring to George Bush, who was at that time president of the USA, was actually a coded, hidden, very strongly political phrase, which would only kind of come into being, would only make sense the moment it's voiced. So I was very interested by this idea of language which is hidden and is internalized in the moment of reading, but in the moment of voicing it, it exposes a true inner meaning. And as we continued our walk and saw, this had been sprayed all over Jerusalem that winter. So there was, it was on many different walls. This is another example, and I was photographing the graffiti, and in front was a busker who was playing the balalaika. And as I went closer to photograph, I noticed that this Hebrew sign that he has on his little kit was translated into English on his money box on the front of the trolley, and it said, "Excuse me, I am deaf musician, but beggars can't be choosers. Please give generously." So then this idea of the shibboleth, of the language border in a linguistic sense, for me, suddenly opened up into all these different dimensions of different forms of meaning, and where the border or the distinction between what I was experiencing of his music, which was a melody and traditional Russian sound with all sorts of cultural associations attached to it, he was experiencing this in a completely different way, which I could only guess would be something to do with, obviously, the sensation of his fingers and the rhythm on the strings, perhaps the resonance of that sound in his body. I'm just jumping backwards to 1995, and a piece I made with my father. At that time, well, shortly after this, still in a sense, in this process of questioning and pulling apart, really, the language that I had been using, thinking about where this language comes from, what forms my language, and how does that language form me? And more broadly, this question about how we are constructed by language, or how our sense of self is shaped by language, how language and the concepts that it introduces to us pins, holds in place these kinds of frames and ways of understanding that we become used to. And playfully looking at this idea of the entry into language as a child, that from the psychoanalytical point of view, that you enter language through the father, and this idea that in the relation with a mother, there is a pre-linguistic relationship to the sound of the voice, where you as an infant, you're in constantly immersed in that mother's voice without being able to distinguish language because you haven't learnt it yet. So you have this non-linguistic sonnet kind of being wrapped up. Kaja Silverman, the American psychoanalytical theorist, talks about the sonorous envelope, which I and then through the father you get introduced to this way of kind of describing and categorising and framing the world and time and space and so on. So this is a piece called Elocution, in which my father and I are in a situation of him speaking certain rhymes that are known by all English kids. You could call them mnemonic devices. You could call them one of the early ways in which we cultural ideas are transmitted to us through these rhymes, Jack in Jail and so on. And I'm in the position of the dummy, the medium, the ventriloquist dummy, that is. But I was also thinking very much about lip sync and that question of inhabiting, embodying the voice, the attempt to embody your voice, make it your own, and your relationship with that voice of authority, if you like. So it was a kind of power play, it was a kind of tussle between an older man and a younger woman, or a father and daughter, however you like to see it. This is just a little clip from a 14-minute piece.
Miss Mac sat on a tuffet, eating her curds and whey. Along came a spider and sat down beside her. Miss nothing. Away.
So that was a moment when that space between us, that space between two bodies.
Perhaps.
The space between us becomes charged with a sense of something, some negotiation going on, being transmitted, is not described, but that space between the bodies, I think, is something which is transcribed over the space between screens and objects in many of my installations. I mean, that's a very simple scenario, but this kind of ventriloquial relationship and this kind of tug, push and pull tension between two bodies, is something which I'm still working with very much. And that idea of having a voice, and the idea that this voice is being produced in the moment. I just wanted to recall the words of Stephen Connor, the writer Stephen Connor, who wrote the book Dumbstruck, which is a history of ventriloquism. He talks about the voice not being an attribute, but an event. He said it's not something you have, but it's something that happens. Which is something which we can particularly relate to in terms of kind of performative situations like that, or performative situations like this, that in which there is something planned, but you're producing the voice and you're producing the ideas in the moment of speaking. And this sense of the voice not being something which is given, not being something which is identifiable as a stable, describable, fixed thing, but something which is actually mobile and unstable, not representable. Perhaps it's one of the reasons I'm so interested in working with the voice, that it's a means to talk about subjectivity which offers some possibilities to escape the frame that is so difficult to escape when one's talking about the visual regime. I want to say a few words about the film that you saw this morning, Barabak's Larrabang, which takes that kind of question of this sort of power struggle which is in which language is so much at stake, or in which language, spoken language, and the way that we speak is such a tool or a weapon in that struggle, in the broader social space of a community, in this case, a community in Liverpool, which is where I live. And the piece came out of a conversation on a train, actually, about accent and dialect and the relationship between ideas of identity and geography and voice, and how so often, as you were talking about in your talk, Susanna, how so often the accent becomes a shortcut way of framing a sense of who somebody is in a very stereotypical way. And I was talking to somebody who was talking about somebody whose voice had allowed them to escape identification and escape the powers that be, the police, for many, many years, the famous drug dealer Cocky Warren, Curtis Warren, whose main weapon, if you like, was backslang, which is a slang that's spoken traditionally in Liverpool by people who use it as a means of survival, really. People, dock workers, poor people who had no economic agency and no political power or kind of control over their lives. They're very much subject to terrible economic conditions and, you know, a very oppressive church and so on. And this language developed out of, first of all, a very practical need to be able to hide your probably quite necessary black economy dealings from somebody who might overhear and put you in prison. So it's a way of disguising language in which phoneme, certain vowels in the flow of speech are replaced by a number of phonemes, and it could be there are three phonemes that they use, is ag, ab, or arab, and they sort of drop these phonemes in place of certain vowels. So it's a very simple system and very easy to decode if you read it, but it is never written. It's a purely oral language, and the effect is to create this impenetrable surface, opaque surface to language. This is Curtis Warren, by the way, at the top, who is, I think, just coming out of jail around now. They finally caught him. They actually caught him in Holland when he had gone over to a farmhouse in rural Holland somewhere, and somehow his guard was down, and for the first time he spoke in he didn't use backslang in mobile phone conversations in Holland, and also in Holland, wiretapping is legal and wiretap evidence can be used in court, whereas in Britain it can't be used in court. So although the police could wiretap Curtis Warren's mobile phone conversations and could have unraveled the meaning had they found somebody to interpret, they could have never used it in court. So this is a language which, on the one hand, is completely transparent for those who are familiar with that sound. And for those who aren't, it's totally opaque and impenetrable. And I thought of it as being like a kind of camouflage, which for people who had very little space of their own, very little elbow room in a sense, it created a space, it produced a social shared space, which they could share, and which could only be entered by those who are part of that community. And as economic conditions have changed and as technology has kind of evolved and this this tool is no longer so needed, it's become, it's no longer a camouflage, but this kind of complex patterned surface has become like an ornament which people are really proud of and they show off, and they, you know, if they can speak it, they enjoy, you know, showing it off, and if they can't, they pretend that they can. This is a chapter divider in the novel Diva. Some of you may have recognised the film that was incorporated into the quote from the film that's incorporated into my film on the big screen, the big pub TV screen at the beginning. That was a clip from the novel, from the film Diva by Jean-Jacques Benet, 1981, which I used as one of several tropes that helped me map out a social space in which different borders or social divisions were kind of rubbing up against each other. So Diva, in brief, the whole story revolves around a stolen or an illicit recording on a cassette tape made by a young messenger boy who was in love with the voice of an amazing opera singer. Her voice is so amazing that she's refused to ever let it be recorded, because she knows that if she does let it be recorded, then any flaw will be laid down for forever, and she can't bear the idea that any mistake could be fixed in that way. So he makes an illicit recording, and at the same time, somewhere else in Paris, on another cassette tape, the lover of a criminal gang boss has made a recording in which she confesses and puts all sorts of information about her boss's drug dealing business and his all the corrupt policemen who are part of that drug dealing business. And the story is around confusion between these two tapes. The drug gang obviously want to get hold of the cassette of the confessions, and a Japanese recording company want to get hold of the only recording that exists of this opera singer. So for me, this was a very useful narrative thread that I could draw through the film. Not a narrative thread that you necessarily need to understand in terms of knowing the story, but just taking some of those tropes and seeing the highly cultivated, the image of a very highly cultivated and refined voice of the opera singer playing with Buster Swaby, the contemporary backslang singer watching. This is the script from the film. And to say something about the script, what was being spoken about in those 10 minutes of the film, it's a patchwork of different materials. I took the phone conversations, wouldn't have been mobile phones in those days, but the phone conversations from the novel, and used that as a script for the two girls who were talking. One of them is actually speaking Birmingham backslang, which uses a different method where they insert illy-gilly, which is even more confusing. Then we have some stories, some coming out of the biographies of the people speaking. And there's one poem from Adrian Henry, known as the People's Poet, who's a poet that everybody knows about in Liverpool, and everyone knows his work. He was known for, in the 1960s, writing poetry using very everyday language. And then there is a commentary from Donna, who's one of the two women, about kind of comparing two figures who represent different class positions and how those class positions have impacted on the way they have kind of found a route to life, both as drug dealers. One is actually was an upper-class drug dealer in the 60s who was part of kind of quite a glamorous socialite scene. When he came out of prison, as she says, he's now going on kind of a world, he's doing talks around the world to, you know, interested audiences, whereas Curtis Warren, coming from the most poverty-stricken, absolutely bottom of the social ladder in Liverpool, he can't talk about anything, she says, he can't talk about nothing. And just an interesting and important aspect to mention in making the work with four people who speak Baxlang. Of course, I myself have to negotiate certain kind of cultural linguistic borders to get contact with the people and to establish trust, to establish sense of mutual understanding. What is this film I'm making? What is it I'm interested in? And it's very difficult because Baxlang, like any dialect or any slang, is like a sign that says, in Liverpool, Baxlang is like a sign that says, I am poor, I am probably criminal, etc. So working, as I often do, through a kind of series of go-between, people who know people, friends who know friends, I came into contact after several months of looking with the four people who are in the film. And they are very proud of Baxlang, and it's a very strong point of identification for them, and also part of a culture which is now disappearing. It's only people really who are over 50 who speak it. So they were very happy that it would be recorded. And three of them had known Curtis Warren. One of them, Cliff, who you saw at the end, talking actually there about this sort of schism between the Somali immigrants in Liverpool and the older generation, mixed race and black community. He had lived down the road from Curtis Warren and had all sorts of stories to tell about him. And all of them were very nervous about mentioning Curtis Warren at all. And the only person who was willing to was Donna. She said, as a woman, you know, the stakes are less high. I mean, Curtis Warren still has many people who he's worked with in his operation are still living in the neighbourhood. The day before I finished the film and I had to have it burned into Blu-ray, she called and said, I'm sorry, Imogen, but you have to take everything out that I've said about Curtis Warren because I'm just too nervous. And in the end, I went through very carefully and took out every instance of his name being mentioned and replaced it with he. But just to say that this kind of interweaving of found narrative from the film of Diva, and then personal narratives, autobiographical narratives from the people who are in the film, and then this kind of the implications of this linguistic social border and how they actually came into and interrupted the process of making the work, how they shaped the work. This is a kind of stepping stone to the piece Sasha, the image of which is on the programme. This is a contemporary C90 police cassette, and I just so enjoy the relationship with the drawing of a police cassette from the Diva novel, because this was recorded 2 years ago. I was doing some research into police interviewing techniques. And one of the main techniques they use is cognitive interviewing technique, which is a process, a very carefully constructed way of asking questions, which is designed to help you to access as much detail as you can of a memory. So it's really used with witnesses and not with suspects, because you have to be very willing to participate in the process. But these interviews, this interview was conducted in a police station with the kind of British authority on cognitive interview technique with witnesses. That conversation we recorded in the way that every police interview takes place with a suspect or a witness or a victim, being recorded on C90 cassettes still, in a little machine that can record four at the same time, one for the police, one for the the interviewee, and two for the archive. And it just amazed me that they're still using this completely antiquated technology. And also by using this, there's no record when there could be a record of all the paralinguistic aspects, the dimensions of what the interviewee says, their body language, their hesitations, their expression, and so on. So for me, it was this incredible blind spot, in a sense, in the very source of gathering evidence. At the time that I was developing the ideas for the exhibition that I mentioned earlier with the first image, the graffiti, the exhibition ended up being called Die Lucky Bush. I came across this newspaper article about Sacha Van Loo. As you can see, in the caption it says that he is who is blind, listens to wife evidence at the federal police station in Antwerp. And the image really caught my attention and seemed incredibly rich and interesting and relevant to so many things that I was working on at the time. First of all, just compositionally photographed from below in a classic way of making the subject somehow have power, and also with his hands on the controls, he's got his hands on the computer keyboard. Behind him is a shooting target practice, which he had actually managed to shoot, as you can see, very close to the heart, just using sound as a reference to shoot. And this newspaper article became the first point in a long process of about 3 years, actually. First of all, getting in touch with him, and then meeting him over the years intermittently, and starting to develop a piece of work which became an installation at Matt's Gallery in London in 2011. So his job is listening to wiretap evidence. He was recruited during a kind of public relations effort by Antwerp Central Police at a time when the Belgian police were in a huge corruption scandal and had also been found to be institutionally racist and so on. And they picked up on a project in Holland where the police had decided to start working with people who may have disabilities but may have also skills. And they had a very far-reaching project in which many people got all sorts of different work with the police. In Belgium, they reduced that kind of idea down to saying, well, blind people are very, very, you know, good at hearing, so let's just recruit lots of blind people to listen to the wiretap recordings, a job that had previously just been done by whichever detective was on the case in which they'd made the recordings. So they recruited 30 blind people with very, very wide, varying degrees of skill and ability. Sasha is particularly skilled because he'd been working as an interpreter. He speaks 7 languages fluently, and he has an amazing ability to recognise and locate dialects and accents. So, for example, he can distinguish between somebody speaking Flemish with a Moroccan accent or with a Tunisian accent, so on. So he is somebody who's very able to read voices and to position voices in terms of their geography, also to read between the words that are being said, to interpret what's being said, to work to kind of work out coded language that's being spoken. And the piece became very much about the politics of listening as much as about the politics of speaking, and the way that as soon as you open your mouth, you are read and you are located, somehow positioned through your voice. This was about listening, and how on the one hand, Sasha's ability and sensitivity in listening makes him an incredibly empathetic and sensitive and receptive person. But then within his job, this listening becomes a very invasive, penetrating tool, really, in that part in the judicial process of determining whether somebody is guilty or innocent. And there's always, of course, a violence, I think, in that. I mean, particularly, for example, he said that he was very uncomfortable when he was working with terrorism cases. And when I first met him, he was working on a case of a young man who he said he just reads the Quran a lot, you know. And I know that he's not a terrorist, but because he's been suspected now, he's not going to be able to shake that suspicion for many years. So he was always kind of fighting and tussling with his own sense of his own position in terms of framing people, representing people, interpreting them, if you like, speaking for them. And this was echoed in his biography. I mean, there's a couple of quotes from a notebook from when I met him, which I found very interesting in terms of the way that he embodied a shift across an ideological border. And made it very difficult to determine really what his position was in his job. And I think this ambiguity and impossibility to to really determine and say, you know, what is my agency, what is my role, even a police wiretap analyst, how layered and complex that situation is. So he, for example, is saying here, I've always said a very ambiguous, a very double thing. We came from a rather communist family, and also here, when my mother was a member of the Communist Party, this is in Antwerp in the 70s, we were a bit, during the Cold War, what can I say, well, to suffer is a big word, but we were at the wrong side during the Cold War. And I know, for example, also that, well, I don't know if our phone has been wiretapped, but I know that we were surveyed, because we went rather often to Ukraine, to Russia. So there you had the police and the state as our enemy. Well, enemy is a big word, but they were very suspicious, and the police were not our best friend. And then he goes on to say, well, as a child, he's talking about his fascination for police work. He says, well, as a child, I like the contradiction of it. On the one hand, the police is your enemy, and on the other hand, you also feel attracted to it. And then when I became an interpreter, then I also thought, okay, I'll be a police interpreter, not for the court, but for police interviews. That was already something which interested me. The human aspect, the psychological aspect of all those tensions you have, how they go about it, how each person is looking for their way to the goal. And then to be in the middle of it as an interpreter, that's what really interested me. You don't choose sides. I mean, as an interpreter, you're neutral. So you're both, in fact. You're the police and you're the other. And here's a short extract from one of the two main video sequences that were part of this spatial installation. Sasha, listening.
Enter from green light field. Muted Alvin. Enter green. Shoshi. Begin. Enter from green light field. Shoshi. Enter. Text van Klem wordt gepakt. A Brazilian Lauf van Ver. Voor de vriend lijstbeeld. Niet geselecteerd op de naam Ibrahim. Pakot ik. A Brazilian Lauf van Ver. Text geknipt en op Klem wordt. Voor de vriend lijst. Voor de vriend lijstbeeld. Niet geselecteerd. Enter. Voor de vriend lijstbeeld. Niet.
So that's him working on his braille keyboard. And sorting through files and folders. And the text-to-speech, which is in Flemish, of his computer was telling him whether the file is secure or not secure, and telling the names of the different folders where he has different voice recordings. And I'm not going to try to describe the installation because I don't want to put you in the position of having to try to imagine something which isn't here. But just to mention that the sound of the computer voice is treated in a very different way in the installation. Already just here, you hear it's, of course, a completely machinic, automatic, artificial voice. And the installation, that voice came out of a flat panel speaker, which has a very penetrating and thin, hard sound. It's a speaker, it's called a panphonic speaker. It's a speaker which throws the sound to up to 30 metres with no dropping of volume. And when you walk through that beam of sound, you really feel it as a resonance in your body. So this idea, this within those two different modes, Sasha really almost, kind of, he's thinking aloud and he's murmuring, not even aware of a producing voice, I'm sure, at that time. He's just concentrating. And as he said to me, when he's working, he concentrates for many hours at a time, sometimes, you know, 2 or 3 hours without moving. And his colleagues are not sure whether he's fallen asleep or whether he's still concentrating. But he has an intensity of concentration in listening, kind of in completely embodying listening. And this voice, very, very soft, murmuring voice, is contrasted then with that kind of machinic voice, which is part of the, I mean, it's part of literally of his desk, it's his office, if you like. It's his part of the bureaucratic machinery, which for me invoked that hard-edged institutional process by which a subject's voice can be identified, can be recorded, captured, interpreted, and then framed, you know, according to guilty, not guilty, and so on. And just in terms of the filming, you know, how to film in such a way that it's not a portrait of Sasha as an individual, and it's also not showing his blindness as the subject, but that it's somehow showing his concentration and his listening. And so for me, one way to attempt that, at least, was to always focus more, well, certainly never any frontal images, but focusing on his, focusing from the side. In fact, people have told me that you can immediately tell that he's blind because the muscles around his eyes are not very developed because he's not using them the way, they're not being exercised all the time in the same way that ours are. But and of course, the implication of that, you know, how to frame a blind person in a way that the image doesn't become about blindness, how to make an image of a blind person, how to deal with the visual at all when you're working with somebody who is blind. Not because the blind person needs to be able to experience that image, not because you have to invoke their experience, their non-visual experience, but because, for me, working with somebody who is blind in a very interesting way, kind of immediately, I am looking at the visual image in a different way already. I'm aware that he's never seen a painterly composition of a body in a space or a body sitting at furniture, and how, of course, it's my framing, but the way he takes up position with his body when he's listening, for me, there was a beautiful composition about it, but I have to ask myself, what do I mean by that? And what does composition, what does visual composition mean to him? So in answering that question, or in answering, in addressing that question, perhaps, I should say, I made use of a technology, 3D laser scanning, which I'd been working with for another project. And as soon as I understood more about how it works, I thought this is something I can use in working with Sasha as a counterpoint to the filmic image. 3D laser scanning, which is used by architects and engineers usually to scan a site, it's the most incredibly precise recording of the topography. So it's a laser beam that hits a rotating mirror and the whole thing is spinning around, so the beam is sending out 40 million times in a certain single rotation, and everywhere that this laser beam touches, that position in space is recorded. And it's the recording, which is abstract data, when you put it into software, you can see as a cloud of points in space. It's called a point cloud. And usually those point clouds are immediately clad in fake skin and natural colouring, and then you can get something like an artist's simulation or for the architect to show their client how a building might look, placed into this actual scanning of the site. But I was using the material of city streets, streets which one could imagine might be exactly where somebody, you know, a wiretap recording is being made, part of the urban social space. This is really bad quality, but never mind. This is running in parallel to Sasha's listening. And just to go back to the point of why is this interesting, the technology is based on sonar, which was developed for U-boats in the Second World War. And in the principle in which it works, it's much closer to how we hear than to how we see. And in the technology that produces this point cloud, there is no optical element. It's a completely non-optical image, in a sense. And of course, I've rendered this as video, and I've made a navigation through these various point clouds that I had made. And it becomes a visual experience for us. But I was very interested in the, on the one hand, the fact that this comes out of this non-retinal paradigm, if you like, and also the way that in moving through the point cloud, the image is always seeming to be in formation. And you see it kind of become coherent, and you see it kind of fall apart into just so many dots. And I think this, for me, this was an interesting parallel with this process that Sasha is going through, listening to this information and sort of piecing together these images, and yet all the time in this condition of deep ambiguity in his own relationship to his work. Now we've got 5 more minutes, and there was one more piece that I was planning to show, but I think rather than try to cover 15 minutes of talking in 5, I'll stop here and maybe invite questions if anyone has any, or comments, if anyone has any comments on what we've been looking at, then we have a few minutes to take in.
In the film that we saw earlier this morning, the camera concentrates quite a lot on the objects in the room, and I think it would be fair to say it aestheticizes them to a great extent. And I just wondered what the strategy with that was, really.
Yeah, I would say that, that they were already completely aestheticized. We were filming in 2 Victorian pubs. And one of the pubs is called The Vines, and the other pub is called, slips my mind, but they're both spaces in which backslang would have been spoken, you know, after shopping, after work, whatever. But one of them, The Vines, which is the very grand but faded and shabby space with a chandelier and a kind of stained glass cupola, for me was a very nice mirroring of the grand opera hall in Paris where Diva, that first shot from Diva is filmed. So I took these environments as spaces which are both completely the places where, you know, where people speaking backslang would spend a lot of time and enjoy this kind of plush traditional English pub interiors with their stained glass, their cut glass and stained glass and beautiful wood. And actually in Liverpool, interestingly, they employed master craftsmen to make these pubs. And I mean, we have those kinds of pubs in London as well, but it's an interesting environment, which is on the one hand, you know, has this amazing aesthetic, sumptuous, gloriousness about it, but it's also really shabby, and of course it's 19th century, so it's quite old now. So it was the concentrating on the environment, also on the bodies, was a way to bring us and a kind of hold us in a visual kind of pleasure in a sense, while listening to a voice or a form of language, which could otherwise be really hard to sit with for very long. I mean, it's really confusing. And our tendency when listening to something we don't really understand is at a certain point just to get frustrated and give up, or to feel alienated from it, or to think, I should be understanding, but I can't. You know, something's wrong, they should have put subtitles. So it was, I wanted to create a space in which, in a sense, you're already so much in the environment, and you're already so close to those bodies. You don't have the distance to say, you know, this is this kind of a place, this is this kind of a person, male, female, black, white, and so on. It's kind of representational identity profiling. It was a way to be in the space of the voice and still having something to look at, and something which is somewhat describing a certain cultural space, but not to the degree that it distracts you from the voice. So that this was the kind of relation that I wanted between the image and the sound. And I think touching on something which Susannah said in her talk earlier about the framing, which happens a lot in my work actually, that this idea of capturing or the politics of representation, you know, how you show somebody, how you show a subject. And I think that very close framing for me is a way to suggest, in general terms, it's a way to suggest that the subject is always more than what is on the frame. The subject is always escaping beyond. And I think also the asynchronizing of the voice and the body, that the fact that the voice is not issuing from that body, it's not tied to it, it's always slightly outside the diegetic frame, outside the frame of the narrative. So the subject is in the narrative, in the frame, they're being shown, we can see who they are, but at the same time they're outside it, slightly beyond it. So there's a kind of that's the kind of thinking around the closeness of the framing, but particularly in the Backslang film, there was also a desire to keep us, you know, almost too close to focus on the subjects in the film, so that there's this kind of suspension in our processes of determining, you know, where we are, who they are, what kind of people are they, etc.
And I suppose I was thinking about that as a material form. I wondered if it was something to do with proof and evidence and the idea that you would visibly see any kind of tampering. And I suppose that idea of working with video rather than film and cassette tape and thinking about the 3D sonar that you were saying with this idea of mapping and it being a kind of non-retinal, I really like that phrase. And so I was just thinking, I guess it's more of a comment, I don't know, but about that idea of the material somehow in the subjects in your work is some kind of evidentiary process.
Yeah, that's a, yes, I mean, it's an interesting relation to make. I became very interested a few, was it 3 years ago? Actually, the point I was using that 3D laser scanning for the first time, the fact that materials and objects can embody, incorporate, can have, or can be actual traces of certain cultural space or social conditions or an event. And I was looking at bricks from a demolition site in an area. I got a laser scan made of a demolition site in Liverpool and was thinking about the relation between the physical fabric of a neighbourhood and the language that evolves in that neighbourhood. What happens when the fabric is wiped away, which has been happening all over Liverpool, part of the Pathfinder scheme for renovating and regenerating a lot across 12 cities in Britain, but it was hitting hardest at 2009 when I was making that work and thinking about how the language is somehow tied to the architecture and even the points of reference in a neighbourhood, like the church, the pub and so on. So the bricks that are left from these houses, bricks made from houses that are considered to be absolutely worthless, but in recycling are worth a fortune and get circled to Japan and so on for being used in smart bars and clubs and so on. It's an interesting process. The voice as a physical material which can pick up traces of social conditions, kind of be inscribed by, and subjective conditions, and making a relation between the voice and physical materials like bricks, or the work that I was going to show, I used a shaman's doll. Well, that was a piece that I made in Busan in Korea, a shaman's doll, which is also a physical trace of a certain belief system. And I think for me, maybe again, I mean, was a coming to this work from sculpture because was I bringing this sculptural sensibility to working with a voice because I trained in sculpture, or did I train in sculpture because of this interest in the materiality of sound, of voice? But it's something which I'm very interested in, how objects can speak and have an eloquence and in terms that cannot be translated. I mean, it's still just a brick, or it's still just a straw doll, or it's still a piece of cassette, but it speaks in this non-language object, voice, if you like.
Okay, I think we've got time for one more question, and then we'll break on to any other questions we can take later.
That's wonderful.
So, who's first?
I just had a really question. What was your work seems to be deal with interhuman communication? And maybe the few thought about the role of technology as something other than just a sort of dumb recording device as a sort of very utilitarian function, if you like, in terms of documenting. And thinking about the sort of forthcoming uses in terms of interpretation and in-depth surveillance, because I think we all know that we're being watched, if you like, all each movement, each like, all these different kinds of being recorded, and my understanding is that there's technology that can develop that can interpret voices in a much more detailed way than humans, for example, even Sasha can hear, understanding lies and things like that, you know, just through the sort of cadence of speech. And I wondered if you're interested in those developments, or if your primary concern really is that sort of interhuman, intersubjective.
I'm very interested in those developments, maybe not so much for what they're going to make possible, but for the sort of fantasy of because I think it is a fantasy as well, and it is a belief system in what technology can offer, what it can do for us, and also the way that different technologies do become ways, that can become prisms or ways through which we can imagine things that would be difficult to imagine otherwise. So it's a bit like when you come across a certain word which you hadn't come across before for a certain meaning, you think, ah, brilliant, that's, yeah, it really helps you to grasp a concept. I think certain technologies can also produce new paradigms or new ways of visualising or new ways of understanding a way of conceiving of a certain idea or a certain kind of phenomenon. But I'm very interested in that, you know, where the limits of that kind of promise or those potentials lie and the incredible hope that we kind of, you know, invest in technology, that it can, and it has, you know, it does extraordinary things. But for example, the 3D laser scanning, I really enjoyed the fact that, of course, the scanner can't scan underneath itself. So it's on a tripod and it has this incredible, like, total territorial control of mapping the area, but it can't go down. So they move the thing around so it can scan the bit that it was standing on before, but sometimes, you know, there's something in the way, so you get this black hole, so there's no data. So there's always a black hole somewhere. There's always a blind spot or a black hole somewhere in all of those technologies. And what's interesting is to have to be able to use them and to be able to also think about, you know, how they're shaping our way of understanding, how they're shaping our way of conceiving and articulating ideas, abstract ideas that are hard to make concrete. So we kind of use those. Even like the camera has been used, you know, of course, it's metaphorically in so many different spheres, including psychoanalysis and so on. So, yeah.
Okay, we're going to move and have lunch now, which is in the bar. Before you go, I'd just really like to thank Imogen for a fantastic